Thanks Edgar for the introduction. I couldn't understand anything, but you said good things about WSO2. So I'm Asanka, Vice President of Solutions Architecture. So I'm an architect and technology evangelist. I'm a committee of Apache Foundation, so I'm coming from a technical background. So I live in San Jose, California, and this is the first time in Brazil. It's a nice country. So today, what I'm trying to do is share some of my experience, like some of the logos Edgar put, like Boeing, eBay. Most of these customers, I closely work with the customer and then help them to build their architecture. So from my experience, I am planning to share some of the good things that you can take out of this. So today, track, basically we start with the architecture, like how you can build enterprise architecture, and then we are moving how you can secure it, and then we are moving into how you can create services and expose them as API, and then finally from the services into APIs, and then how you can build applications. So from data to stream, we are going to explain how you can build application. So we are using WSO2 as the implementation or the runtimes, but we will be using more generic patterns and the standards while we are doing this thing. And at the end, we are doing a panel that gets some of the customers who has implemented these solutions here, so they will share their experience with you. So that's the agenda. So the patterns, basically, I think most of you are familiar with some kind of patterns, like there are design patterns associated with the programming, and then architecture patterns, so on and so forth. So the why we need patterns, basically, it's something that somebody used it before. Because of that, it's error-proof. So you don't need to worry about using the pattern. The second advantage of a pattern is it's a common way to communicate. Especially, I treat it as the language of architects, because it's really easy to communicate when you are speaking on by using a pattern. And then the last thing is, you have a catalog. Like when you try to, when you get a problem, and then when you try to find a solution, then when you have a set of patterns, a catalog of patterns, you feel really comfortable because you know there's a solution that you can find from your pattern catalog. So that's the advantage of having a set of patterns. So the first thing is about the enterprise architecture. This is what the textbook says. So it's kind of an exercise that most of the larger organizations doing that look at the across the entire organization. So organization might have number of business units, but they will look at it as a architecture across all the business units, and then define some set of strategy practices that align with their policies and then business goals. So that's basically the enterprise architecture. So to understand that, this is the best documentation, this framework called SACMON framework. I really like it. Like if you are working on enterprise architecture, SACMON framework is a really good thing, because it defines what are the processes that you have in enterprise architecture, and then what are the documentation that you need to create in this exercise. You don't need to do everything based on the project that you are working on, and based on the organization that you are working on, you can pick these things. So this is a good framework to define the enterprise architecture. Then moving into service-oriented architecture, because this is the key pattern that we use in most of the modern application development. It's not new, I think started around 1998. And now it has come to a really good architecture pattern. So in textbook, it says architecture pattern that to build highly loosely coupled systems. That's what the textbook says. But from my experience, I believe it's nothing new. It's architecture style that you can use to fix broken architecture. So that's my experience about service-oriented architecture. So if you look at how it started, service-oriented architecture started with three components. A service provider who write the services, and a service broker that will advertise the services, and a service consumer that will go look up the service, subscribe for it, and execute the service. This is how the service-oriented architecture started. So we call it as the SOA triangular. So that's how it started. But it didn't cover all the requirements to build the enterprise architecture. So it started improving, and there are different architecture layers came and introduced into SOA. And if you look at it today, it has become like more complicated, different layers, data, business processes, APIs, and then on top of that you get all the liberation. So that's how we see it today. And if you look at it at the runtime now, that conceptual architecture you need to bring and deploy, it's more complicated because you might need to run some of your processors in your local area network and some of your processors in your external facing network. And then to have high availability, scalability, you need to run these processors in multiple or distributed manner. So it looks really complicated if you look at it today. Then the challenges the enterprise architecture facing, the less visibility to projects, because initially when organization started a project, everybody knew what's really happening because most of the projects were funded by IT. But it got changed around the early 2000. The project started funded by business units. Since each and every business unit got their own funding, they started their projects. So there's no way that enterprise architecture got the visibility about who owned the project and what are the availability of these projects. Then the next change, I think most of you, when you started your career, like we had the luxury to deliver a project in a year. So the most project life cycles were a year, 2 years, like that. But today it has changed, like it is a kind of 6 to 2 months, and most of the projects are now weeks because business unit needs something up and running by a week. So we don't have much time to deliver, we have to quickly deliver. And then change management became an issue because once you release the product, there should be a proper change management because the changes that you are doing, you have to properly test it, as well as there should be version control. So change management became another challenge in that as well. Then most of the things got standardized during last 5 to 6 years. Like people start using like protocols like REST, SOAP, and then protocol buffers and type of standards. That is from the technical side. And then each and every business, like if you look at the insurance sector, they move ahead with the standard called a code. All the messages were standardized using a code. And then if you look at healthcare, people started using a standard called HS7. In the financial sector, they started using FIS. So again, it became a challenge because traditionally, each and every organization, they used to use their own standards, but industry looking for these type of defined standards. So that became another issue. Then the integration, because like you can't just install an application system. It can be a HR system, or it can be a kind of a CRM system, a document management system. The individual system can't run and provide a big value for the business. It has to be integrated. So integration became a key reason as well as a key requirement to have a proper system. And then again, the next challenge is the heterogeneous system because different systems develop using different standards like .NET, Java, J2EE, then PHP, Python, different type of languages. So interoperability and dealing with the heterogeneous system became another issue. So those are the challenges that people start facing. Then it became more complicated because it's not about services, it's not about applications. Today, if you develop a system, it has to be aware with mobile, social, and then cloud aware. And then it has to be driven through APIs, and then big data doing a huge thing with analytics, and then DevOps playing a huge role, and open source has become another necessity. So these are the next challenges that we have. So if you look at the architect, it looks like this because all these business challenges are there, technology challenges are there. So how you can build a system? So as a solution, we kind of identified a way to position this thing. So modern applications are systems of systems. So that's the beginning of this thing. So this actually not something we invented. So Gartner came up with this idea in 2012 that you can define any architecture into 3 layers: system of record, system of differentiation, and system of innovation. But this didn't work properly. So the idea behind here, this is your data layer, this is your processing layer, and top of that you have all your UIs or the user interactions that happen. But it didn't work properly. So Forrester came with another idea, like the system of record, system of engagement, and system of automation. So the system of record is your data layer again, it didn't change. System of engagement is the UIs, like the delivery channels that we have, mobile apps, web apps, so on and so forth. System of automation is the facilitator that things like Puppet, Chef, Task, DevOps, all these things are system of coming under system of automation that facilitate how you can build a system, basically bring your system of record into system of engagement. So with that, we came up with this idea of how you can represent the enterprise architecture today. So if you look at from here, these are the architecture layers that we have. Source system of record, right? Basically where you store the data. The system of records, how you access this data. And then you need some kind of a data virtualization. Because we have different type of data models in our physical storages, but we need some kind of different data models to provide it as API or provide access it to the web. So we need to do some kind of a data virtualization. That's why it comes into picture. Top of that, you have all your services, orchestration, traditional service-oriented architecture-related stuff. And in our definition, services are not accessible. APIs are the accessible. So to access the services, you need the API layer, and it comes top of the services layer. In top of the APIs, you get all the delivery channels, that's the system of engagement, and applications like web apps, mobile apps come in on top of that layer. So that is one view of this picture. Next view, you need to develop the application, then you need to publish the application, okay, this is available as an app, and then you need to consume and run the application, that those are the actual runtimes. And you need to secure, you need to govern, and you need to monitor. So you don't need to worry about everything. You can understand, identify your requirement, and then position what are the pieces that I require to build my solution. So this is a really good way of looking at today the enterprise application. And if you look at the system of automation, that all the tools that we need to build, develop, and manage this application come across the all architecture layers that we have. So still we are working on this diagram. This is the version 1 of this, so it will get improved in future. So the SOA is the main pattern that we are looking at. But in addition to that, there are a couple of other patterns that you can use. The first thing is event-driven architecture. Like usually most of the system work on request response manner, but it doesn't work for each and every solution. That's where the publish and subscribe come into the picture. A really nice pattern to have proper loosely coupled systems, because in a publish and subscribe system, that subscriber can come at any time and subscribe for a interesting event feed. And that system can unsubscribe at any time that when it doesn't need. So you can have a proper loosely coupled system using event-driven architecture. Then the next one is web-oriented architecture. I think most of you are familiar with MVC. So this is kind of how you can combine MVC with SOA. So the idea here, like, you will not have kind of more client-side processing. So client will be just a rendering unit. And it will consume services to get data and then render in the UIs. It can be a mobile app, it can be a web app, same architecture. So that's where the web-oriented architecture comes, that you can combine the SOA with your application development. Then the enterprise integration patterns, because we identified integration is a key requirement. So how you can build integration? You can identify your own way of doing it. But if you want to stick to patterns, EIPs or the enterprise integration pattern is the best way, because it defines each and every scenario that you can look at. Okay, I need to send a message, and if it fails, then I need to retry. Okay, how you do it. So best way is, there are two ways of doing it. The first EIP call store and forward. Second EIP call dead letter challenge. So you can, based on your performance requirements, because if you use store and forward, what will happen, it will add some kind of a latency, because you always store and then forward the message. So if you don't want to get that latency added to your the messages, what you can do, you can use the data channel. So that basically, it first send the message, it fails, then only store the message, the KDN messages will get stored, and then it start processing the messages in a given time interval. That is the data channel. That, like that, there are a lot of enterprise integration patterns available. Any integration scenario can map to one EIP or many EIPs. And there's a book called Enterprise Integration Patterns. If you're working on integration, that should be your Bible, because it defines all the patterns that you have to build a solution. And there are keep on adding patterns. I saw like recently they have added more RESTful patterns, because that support RESTful scenarios. And the last thing is Internet of Things, so that is where everybody is talking today. So you can add more, like it's basically, for me, the modern, I mean a derived version of the EDA or event-driven architecture and SOA, that you can use micro devices and collect data and process them. That's where the IoT comes. So these are the additional patterns that you can use to build a proper solution on top of your SOA. So the now you might think, okay, how can you get there? So that's my main goal, to help you or explain you how you can get there. So the first thing is the requirement stage. Like, so we used to do this exercise like in traditional software development processes. A business analyst will come and then look at the requirements and then document it. He or she will prepare a 100-200 page document. Nobody will read it. And the architect will come, he or she will start the requirement analysis from the beginning and develop the system. So that is the way that systems work. So that's where this new concept called, so business analyst is not a kind of a popular job today. There's a new role called a business architect has come into the picture. That a person who has more kind of technical background, look at the requirement and then define architecture spikes. So one page documents or two page document that architect or a development team can take and build a solution rather than going through a massive document. So that is the new way of identifying the requirement. So that how this exercise basically, you should get the requirement from the business unit. And then you have to look at what are the current applications and systems available. Rather than invent everything from the scratch, you have to identify what are the available systems that you can use. And then identify the data. So that's the first step that you should do. How to reuse the existing stuff and then fill the architecture gap. So that's why I position SOA as the pattern to kind of rebuild or the fix the broken architecture. Yes, because you can identify the data and use the principles and building solution after that. So once you identify the requirement, you can define the business architecture. So that's the business requirement. And then you can go to the solutions architecture level. That's where you define the solution. So it done by two levels. We call it as level 0 and level 1. So I will show some examples in the next slide. But in high level, level 0 is kind of a vendor neutral diagram that you tell, okay, I need these pieces in my architecture. It's just a component diagram that define what are the necessary pieces that you require in that architecture that you're looking at. Then the level one architecture, it defines what are the products actually you are going to use to build this thing. Are you going to use Tomcat? Are you going to use Hadoop, Cassandra, whatever the products available, you define your L1 architecture. Then you go for the application architecture. Now you have the high level idea, okay, these are the building blocks I require to build this. But what are the in details stuff? What are the integration requirements that you have? And what are the data models associated with this? And then what are the APIs that you are going to expose from this? Like that, you define the detailed technical architecture under the application architecture. In the last exercise, something that we didn't do in most of the traditional architecture exercises, to look at how this thing run in at production systems. Because the usual practice, you develop something and then when you put it into test, then only you identify there are issues that you can't run this in the target runtime. So in this exercise, we identify it at the beginning. First thing, do a capacity time. Because you should understand how much of instances, how much of processing power you require. To do the capacity planning, what you require is the peak load. So you can, like, if you have the historical data, you can easily identify the peak load. But if you don't have the historical data, at least you can go to your business units, like marketing, sales, and then identify what are your projections. And based on that, you can get some kind of an idea how much peak load that your system will hit in a given time. So that's the key reason that you need it. And then that's the throughput, basically, how much messages that you need. And then there's another requirement, latency, because you have an end user, and then that end user will not wait n number of time. It has to be in an acceptable latency, so you need to identify what's my latency that I'm looking at. So as example, Edgar explained eBay. So eBay, first requirement they had, a message around the added latency from the middleware layer should be less than 3 milliseconds. So that was their requirement, but we achieved around 2.3 to 2.4 millisecond latency. Like that, you need to identify your the capacity planning requirements. Then the deployment. Where are you going to deploy this? Are you going to deploy in your data center? Are you going to hire a hosting service? Are you going to Amazon? Are you going to Rackspace? Or are you going for a virtualized environment? Now today, virtualization has divided into two. Like, you can get hypervisor-based systems and you can get container-based stuff like Docker. So you need to identify where I am running this thing at that level. Then the last thing is the security, because there can be some certain security standards that you need to apply based on your company policies, as well as there can be industry standards. And then again, there can be restrictions coming from your the data centers, like, because the DevOps and TechOps might tell you can only do one-way communication from my firewall. And like that, you have to identify what are the security requirements you have and then define your security architecture. I'm not going in detail. Prabhat, who will be doing the next talk, will explain the detail DevOps security. So this is one example of a L0 architecture that you just define. Okay, I need a mediation layer, I need an internal API layer, I need external API layer, so and so forth. Just identify what are the high level things that you need to build the architecture. So this is the L0 diagram, and then when we are moving to L1, you map all the products. So I used something I used earlier, but it shouldn't be only WSO2 stuff, like other in the products can come in as well. So you put all the products that you are going to, or the runtimes that you are going to build the architecture. That's the L1. And I use a standard thing. I think mass data management is something common most of you know. So this is the L0 diagram of a mass data management. You have a repository, you need governance, you have events, you need security, and then there's a life cycle of a MDM event, and then there should be an interface to access MDM. So that is the L0 diagram. And then you convert it to the L1 by putting what are the products that you need to build this type of service. So that's L1 and L0. So then the next thing about how you can do this in an iterative manner. So this is kind of a diagram that I usually use. Like, when we walk to an organization, this is what we see. Like, you have some set of services running, nicely done, and then you have some legacy applications running, and you have some databases. Top of that, people will see all the web apps, mobile apps nicely running, but in between, there's a mess. Because people started integrating using different technologies, there was no governance, there was no security. So what happened, it works, but people even don't touch this piece because they don't know what will happen. So the problem with that, people will not do anything new because they can't touch this piece, because they don't know how the impact it will be. So our main, how we are helping most of the organization to clear this mess and then define a proper governed way of integration. So the integration will be still there, but it will be a more governed and proper managed way. So how you do it, basically? So the first advice we are giving for organization to start with the identity and access control, because you will see number of user stores in organization, like a lot of LDAP, Active Directory, databases. There are a lot of users. And then there are a lot of security standards inside the organization. So how you can unify these things, how you can kind of have a proper federated governance solution, sorry, federated security solution, how you can standardize your security and then provide security as a service for the developers, basically, because they spend a lot of time to reinvent security in their application. So the first advice for the customer to get the identity or the security layer done properly and then unify them. The second step basically is the services, because you might have some set of services, but some of the legacy applications might not cannot access as a service. So identify a way, like the popular way is having some kind of adapters with the legacy system, and then expose them as new services. And if you need to write new services, it can be SOAP, it can be REST, it can be JMS or whatever binding. So you can start writing new services in an application container. In the second, the third step, now you have your services, you need the place to identify the services. That's where the registry and the repository come into the picture. You put a registry and a repository and then advertise all your services in the registry, so you know what are the services available, and not only the service availability, it identify the dependency. Okay, I'll take an example from SOAP world. Like if you get a SOAP service, you have a visitor WSDL file that defines the service. Then the WSDL file will have a dependency with the schema, a policy. So when you put this information in the registry, it will show all the dependencies, as well as you can identify what's the impact. Like, okay, I change the policy one, then how many services using this policy and what is the impact? Like that, you can manage these things properly when you put it in the registry. Then the next step is start integrating. So avoid point-to-point integration and then introduce a mediation layer. So we call it as the ESB, like it's a common word. And use a ESB and then start building this integration by avoiding point-to-point connectivity. So you might need to do a lot of mediation when you do integration, because you might need to transform messages, you might need to route the messages, you might need to bridge security, like that. Apply all the mediation requirements at the mediation level and then build the internal integration on top of the ESP, so you know what connect with what, and if you want to do a change, you will go and do at the mediation level. Then the next thing is the external integration, because today you can't just internally integrate it and survive, because we use a lot of SaaS applications. Like so Salesforce is a common thing, a lot of organizations use Salesforce. And then Workday, Twitter, Facebook, those things you need to connect with your applications to have proper social interaction. So then you build the external integration. So in our architecture, we call them as connectors, that you go and define these external endpoints and then build the connectivity. Then the next thing is, now you have your services, but as I explained earlier, in our definition, services are not consumable. APIs are the consumable. So to make the APIs consumable, you put an API layer on top of your services and make it a proper consumable layer. So there are two levels of registries coming in this architecture. Service registry that define your backend services, and API registry, or we call it as API store, that the developers, application developers, come look up for the API, subscribe, take access token, and then consume the API. So we are doing API management talk as well. Rakhmanu is doing, so he will kind of do a demonstration of that as well. So if you are interested, you can come there and do. Then now you have the basic stuff done. Now you need the quality of services. So how you can monitor, because now you are providing your services to access by your applications, you need to monitor who's accessing what. And even if you want to build, like one business unit provides some set of services, another business unit want to invoke it, you might you can bill it from other service provider. Or if you are providing this as a service for external consumers, again you can charge from them. So you need monitoring, analytics and audits, because you need proper control over the system. Then the next thing is CEP. So yesterday I did a detailed talk on complex event processing. So CEP adds a lot to this type of an architecture. Two things. One is noise cancellation, because when you build an event-driven type of a system, there are a lot of events. The system is flooded with events, but you don't need every event. So you can do some kind of a noise cancellation mechanism by putting a complex event processor, as well as you can filter events and then generate important events events out of the your system using a CEP or the complex event processing engine. Then to fill in the blanks, you can add more stuff, like you might need some workflows, and you might need some business rules, and you might need some dashboards. So you can bring different runtimes into this picture and then fill the requirements. So that's the last step that we recommend to do, and bring these additional components into your architecture. So that's where, as an organization, we provide a complete middleware stack, because like most of the middleware vendors, they have a ESB or they have a registry, but we identify this problem from an architect point of view, because when you start building the architecture, you need different runtimes. That's why we are providing a complete stack. So do I need the entire platform? Answer is no, because you will need, based on the needs. So the diagram that I earlier put, the system of system, is the best way to start. Identify what are the runtimes you need, and then pick it from the platform is the best way to do that. Then the next level is cloud, because how you can go beyond the stuff that we discussed. First thing is the platform as a service, and then software as a service. So, and then how you can make cloud native. And then we have application lifecycle management system as well, because you might need to do application lifecycle management when you are building applications. So we call it as a factory. I'm not going in detail all this information available. So the beauty of this platform, the same programming model applied for on-premise application development and cloud application development. So you don't need to be a cloud application developer as such, because the same programming model applies. And then same solution architecture applied for cloud and on-premise as well. And same deployable artifacts, because that is key. Most of the architects and organizations, they start building solutions on-premise, and then when they think I should go for a cloud strategy, then there should be a way to smoothly. So our model, like same deployable artifacts, you can take and then deploy in cloud and on-premise, and so on and so forth. As a result, you get a cloud-based deployment as well as a cloud-native application. So cloud-native means multi-tenanted, elasticity, scalable, and you should be able to build, meter, that type of features we position as cloud-native application. Then the next thing you might think, okay, you are now building a system. So what will happen to the current system, data, and people? Because for me, the last thing is the most important thing and most challenging thing when you start building a new thing. There are a lot of resistance coming. The first two thing is technical stuff we can easily deal, but last thing is a problem. So the first two things, the answer, you will not throw the old stuff that you are using. That's what I told, like you have to identify what are the existing things that you can reuse. So how you can bridge the old world and the new world, the advice is to use the API management. So put the API layer in between your old world, old services and data, and then make them accessible by the new system, so you can bring all the old systems into the new system. So that's how you can reuse the existing stuff. And then about the people thing, the best advice is to engage them. The entire the development team, architect team, test teams, engage them. And then you should empower them, and you should make them accountable, as well as you have to use an iterative process build this. So I will tell an example of this. So we started building a system, and then there was a security gateway running in that particular data center, written by some kind of scripting. And then we proposed them to use our identity server, because it's a proper standard way of doing this thing. And most of the architects did agree with this approach, but one guy said, this doesn't work. And I tried to explain him again and again, okay, no, this is the best way, this is a standardized way, but he's telling this doesn't work. Then I got Prabhat, he's our, the guru of security, like he's the best person to answer all security questions. So Prabhat came into a call and explained this architect, what's the advantages, he said no. So for some reason I told him, at that point, you are the person who's implementing this thing. And then he said, yes, this works. So the problem he had, not the technical problem, he thought he's out. he had a huge problem with his job security because a new system coming into the picture and he will lose his job. So that is his resistance, and he's repeatedly telling this doesn't work. So I think as architects, that is one part you have to handle the people management, because that's where the engage, empower and accountable thing comes. You have to make sure everybody is secure, and then we use their skills to build a new system. So that's an advice from my experience. And lastly, but those are challenges, but you need to do something like this code. So if you want to do something, if you want to improve, you have to do changes. So how you do the change and how you kind of apply it is the challenge, but we have to accept it. So that's where you can build a new system and apply these new architecture patterns in the future. So that's all I have, and we have a party today, and it's an invitation only party. And so you are all welcome to join us. And if you have any questions, I am happy to answer any questions. Any questions? Yep.
Talk about the present factor, from a static point of view. Talk a little bit more about the role of the enterprise architecture as a driver for enterprise transformation also. Yeah, that's not this static because the way that you put it is enterprise architecture as a kind of static. Yeah, but a kind of static concept.
Yes.
But for me it's much more about than just static concepts or artifacts, but also about transformation, enabling transformation.
Yeah.
So, what do you think about that? How we can use this architecture in order to facilitate all those transformations?
Yeah. So the I believe your transformation is it kind of a technical level transformation of messages or kind of
more level. Yes, okay.
Yeah. So that's the basically the as an architect you have to be an evangelist as well. So it's basically an education process. That how, and then the key thing is ROI. You have to hit based, this jargon doesn't work when you pitch it to a business person. So how you can improve the developer productivity. That's the first thing, because this builds an ecosystem that provides a lot of developer productivity, so they will save time. Number two is the standardization. So you are not alone, like you are not doing something unique for you. You are ahead, you are like aligned with what the industry is using. So that is the second thing. And then again, how you can make changes, because business, they do quick changes. So how the technology can do quick changes with the improvements that we are making at the business level. So pitching it from the ROI is the best way, and then identify a iterative or the incremental way. What's the first change that we are bringing? Second change. And with that, what are the applications that we are releasing? Because if we are not releasing any application, doing stuff at the middleware or the backend level, the business people, they can't see. Best way to get some dashboards done. Then they have the visibility. And stuff that they can use and then improve their day-to-day work is the best thing to pitch it and then apply this changes. I assume my answer. Any other questions? Yeah.
About the microservices trend fit in this landscape.
Okay. So personally, I don't really microservices. So the thing is, it's kind of so if you look at the SOA fundamentals, service fundamentals. So that's it, right? That have a a service that is doing some kind of a business problem and then associated with some set of data. So that is the fundamental of service-oriented architecture. People didn't do it properly. Now they are finding different ways to fix it. That's where the microservices come into the picture. And then every organization can't afford this thing. So when I talk to customers, what they are telling, I'm writing microservices, but it's not Netflix type microservices, because Netflix is the one who's doing it at the proper level, because they have enough development capabilities and they have a proper infrastructure to facilitate it. So then my question, then what is it like? If it is not Netflix type microservices, what is it? Then it's just a service. So the that's a problem. And so if you want to build microservices, we provide enough capabilities, especially the data services, because the microservices concept, the API, service, and data type are coupled. So you can easily create a data service out of your data model and then expose it as an API. So we do that thing. But my belief is APIs are more powerful than microservices, because if you have a perfect world that you can write your services, you can do microservices. But most of us, like, the services are there available, so we can't rewrite everything. We have to reuse them. Then you can put the mediation layer and then the API. So API can use as an alternative for microservices. So that's my personal view. But we support microservices as a runtime development.